Hey, welcome back to the second part of the tutorial of NumPy. In the first part, we have discussed this important concept of use, and I just want to give you a brief example of how crazy things one can do with use by manipulating strides. I mean, this is not meant as part of the material which I want to teach you, but just to give you an idea of what one can do. Let me just produce a matrix, which is quite innocent looking, a 2x2 matrix, 16 elements. And now if I choose the strides to be 16, 16, try to figure out what we get then, get this matrix. How do you get it? Well, 16 means, since the item size is 18, 60 means you go in steps of two elements, and no matter whether you're going horizontally or vertically, you always go in steps of two objects. That means if I go this way, I just take every second object, so repeat for six. If I go in this direction, I also take every second object. So these are the same data, but just a different view. And of course, if I something different, because you have a different size, then you have to divide by two. But if I could also go in steps of four bytes, then I get something crazy, right? Because I'm jumping in the middle of an integer, and Python just interprets what's there. So what I want to say here is, if you do tricks like this, and this part is my tricks, then you're responsible for whatever happens, and bad things will happen at that point. Okay, but that was just to get you back into discussion here. Let's try to create some matrices. So far, yeah.
I wanted to ask about the strides. Does that also work with like three bytes?
In principle, yes, you can do any, but then this is even more
weird. Okay, yeah, might help me.
Any integer bytes is a valid step size.
Good.
So there might be applications for that, but I don't know.
Yeah.
Okay. But I mean, there you really should know what you what you're doing. But I mean, you can do a lot of things. Might be interesting. Okay. So far, our usual way to create arrays was really by writing down lists of lists and converting them into an array. That's often not what you do, and quite often actually the first step to create an array is to create an array of zeros. Yeah. So what you can do is you can just say, I want to have an array filled with zeros of a certain shape. So the first argument is shape. Here I'm saying I want a 4x4 matrix filled with zeros. Actually, you can also ask for an empty array. But watch out, an empty array doesn't mean that it's filled with zeros. That's why there's the mental zeros. An empty array just takes some chunk of memory and takes whatever is there. So it's your responsibility to make sure that all elements are filled again. Whereas often one has an array where only some matrix elements need to be filled, or other matrix elements should be zero. And then the best thing is to start from zeros. Okay. And then, of course, we get an array filled with zeros. Now, question for you. How do I get an array filled with ones? It's already... Oh, but you're supposed to do the 4x4 array. Was to give you a hint. Okay, you discovered it right away. Okay. 4, 4. Okay. And of course, if you want to do something more complicated, as you have already discovered, you can do that, of course. Now, how do you do an array filled with tens? Not likely. Tens, twenties, thirties. This is not the right way to do it. So how could we do it?
We can just multiply the error
with right. I mean, we can do computations with ones. This is actually not as innocent as it looks like. And you might say, of course, if I multiply a lot of ones with 10, I get a lot of tens. There is some logic behind it, which I need to explain to you as we go on.
How can I force it to be an integer?
You could, we have said that the default type is float, so I could say the b type should be int, and then it's integer. So you can define the type. So in particular for the, that's interesting also for the zeros, if you define a d-type of boolean, oops, then zeros will be false. So that's a way to initialize a boolean array. So in principle, we can multiply an array in this way, but there's more to tell you about that. I'll come back to this point later. What you often have is diagonal matrices. So suppose I want to have a 4x4 matrix with 1, 2, 3, 4 on the diagonal, and just say P-like. It's in the diagonal matrix. Now, this this function, this method, has an optional argument k. So I would like to ask you to experiment with it. If you say, in addition, comma k equals 1 or minus 1, just try out what happens then. So you see, the numbers are shifted from the diagonal. At the same time, the array has become a bit larger to accommodate all the values. But in this way, you can fill off-diagonal elements. Sometimes it's very useful. If you happen to work in condensed matter physics, and you know what a tie binding model is, I mean, the matrix for the hopping between different lattice heights can be immediately constructed in such a way. If you don't know what that is, what I'm talking about, don't worry. But I mean, it happens occasionally that you have matrices where you mostly have diagonal elements and some of diagonal elements in such a way, which you can easily fill. Extracting?
Yeah.
Oh, you mean to below the diagonal? Only if you want, then you need to reduce. No, then you have to flip the matrix around.
So I can do k set to minus 1.
Oh no, you can set it to minus 1, then you'll go below the diagonal. But I think that was not your question.
No,
then you can do it this way. Then you have to flip the matrix. You will left, right, flipping of the matrix, and up, down. Feeling this is more possible. Okay, this one is just done. Now, if I do diag on a 2D matrix, what do I get then? So, task for you is define a two-dimensional matrix. Remember, just for simplicity, A range of, let's say, 16, reshape it into a 2x2 or 4x4 two-dimensional matrix and try to operate NP diag on this two-dimensional matrix. What happens? matrix is NP, A range, 16 for each floor. This looks like this. That's I matrix. That's just the diagonal. So this works basically in two ways. If you start out with a one-dimensional array, it produces a diagonal matrix, or matrix with the shifted diagonal. If you do it the other way around, it extracts the diagonal elements. Sometimes can be useful. Then there's another function, np.i, which is somehow related. To find out what a function does, if you know its name, you can just ask for help by npinfo, for example. This returns a 2D array with 1s on the diagonal and 0s elsewhere. So that's basically a bit simplified. You don't have to create first the 1D array in order to create this diagonal element. The I function will do this for you. And now suppose I want to have a matrix which looks like this. And the task for you is to create this by means of the I function. Try this. Might help to read the documentation briefly. Let's see that we managed to produce this matrix without typing in all the matrix elements explicitly. Imagine this should be a 1000 by 1000 matrix, then you definitely don't want to type in all the matrix elements. And you don't want to write loops over the matrix elements to fill the matrix. You want to do it as simple as possible. How do we do it? Well, the I function has the argument n. You see, all other arguments have default values. So n is really the important argument which you first have to take a look at. It tells you the number of rows in the output. So we have a 3x3 matrix, so n should be 3. Well, there is another argument, which is m, the number of columns. But you see, this has a default value. So if this is none, if it has its default value, it defaults to n the number of rows. So this would be a square matrix. So there's no need to put in n. It's sufficient to specify n. K, as before, gives you a shift relative to the main diagonal. And well, we can to make sure that the data type is correct, we can fix the data type, which by default is float. So this tells us that we produce NPI of 3, p-type is NPInt. Now in the main diagonal we want to have 2s, so we have to multiply by 2. And then we add NP.I 3 k equals 1. And plus np.i 3 equals minus 1 p type.
Klammer, ja genau. Ja.
This is this automatism in IPython that there are extra brackets and yeah. Okay, so you just add up 3 times i's, multiply them and shift the icons. Yes.
Yes, the good way to assign the same value to all elements of an array is to create an array of 1 and then multiply by the number.
Yes.
That's
the easiest way to do it. I think that's a very transparent way to do it. Because in this way you don't have to attribute a value to each element. One way, and NP1s, I mean these functions are supposed to be very efficient because their NumPy really knows what to do and to do it in an efficient way. Okay, something one actually needs relatively often, particularly if you're doing simulations for example, that's to create random numbers. And often in a simulation, what you might end up doing is you create one random number after the other and you run your simulation. The advantage here in NumPy is that you can create a lot of random numbers in one run. So this is relatively efficient, and you can even define the shape. So I'll get a here with a random ren. This gives me numbers between 0 and 1. In a matrix of a given shape. So this will be a 5x2 matrix of random numbers. Of course, each time I'm running this, I'll get different random numbers. So this is 0.4, 1.5. I run it again, I'll get a different number. Well, sometimes you want to have your code to be reproducible. So what you can do is you can define the initial C, and then you'll always get the same random numbers. So here I have started 191. So I run this again, I get the same random numbers. Okay. So you can do this in a reproducible way. And now occasionally you have matrices. Oh, sorry, yeah.
To clear the column, you have to set a C, or will it use the same C?
No, if you clear the column, then everything is washed away.
Yeah, sure, but if you just execute the first line where you produce random numbers.
This one here?
Yeah, then clear the column and reduce using again. Are they different from this set? Or
they are different.
Okay.
Yeah.
So
there's no
initial C which is set all the time.
No. I mean, we can try this, but. You just have to import a few things again. So let's see. First, we have to import SOP and Cloud remember the random numbers. I think you remember that there was no 0.64 on the top, so don't have an initial seed in the column. That would actually also be not a good way to produce random numbers. I mean, it's really the seed which defines the random numbers, which give you well-defined random numbers. If you don't want that, you shouldn't get it arbitrarily by just the column defining something. There's no initial seed in this sense. No well-defined initial seed. Right? And it makes sense because that's what you might want, that if you don't want it, you should fix the seed yourself. Now, when you are using NumPy arrays, you will find out that if you have 100 by 100 arrays, for example, then NumPy will not be showing all matrix elements anymore because that doesn't make sense. 100 by 100 matrix is not well representable. It will typically show you some of the matrix elements to give you some impression of your matrix. But what's actually sometimes quite useful is a graphic representation because it gives you some idea about the structure in the matrix. So that's what I'm showing here for some random data. This is a 20 by 20 matrix, still relatively small. And you can just use from the matplotlib library imshow on the data. I define a color map, which is hot. That means it goes basically from black to white over red, yellow, and so on. And I don't use any interpolation. This is important to get well-defined squares which represent your data. And then you get, well, this random image in this case, but in your case where you have a well-defined matrix with non-random data, you might have some structure here which is interesting. Of course, now you can even plot a 200 by 200 matrix, no problem. And it would be difficult to represent this now really as numbers on the terminal. And you would really have to analyze the data really very carefully. Another application of random numbers, suppose I'm casting dice. That means I choose random numbers between 1 and 6. 7 is not included. And I'm doing this by throwing 100 throws with 3 dice. And I basically ask what is the distribution in a histogram. So I have this matrix with 3 different dice. These are the throws. This is the histogram already. You don't see the casts on it. So these are the casts of the 3 different dice. Now I can ask, what is the distribution between the outcomes 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 for the different kind of dice? The first one is the blue one, and so on. And you see, well, it's more or less equal. You probably need to throw a bit more often the dice to have this bit more equilibrated. Now, we come back to the problem which we were discussing at the beginning, slicing. So we have an array, and we know that we can have different views on our array. And one way to have a specific view on an array is by slicing. And slicing in principle works in the same way as with lists, except that we have several dimensions. So in one dimension, this is basically trivial. As usual, the first element has index 0, negative indices count from the end of the array, slices have the form start, stop, step, and if you omit values, or if you omit start, it will start from the beginning, if you omit stop, it will go until and including the last element, and steps will be 1 in all elements. So let's try to do that. We create an array 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and so on until 9. And now it's again your turn just to check that what you learned in the beginning for the list still works here. So please try to reproduce these arrays here by slicing the array. So really working precisely the same way as before. So you can just be saying that means as before. Higher dimensions will be more interesting. A789, that starts at element 7, goes all the way until the end. So 7 colon is enough. 2, 4, 6, 8. A, we start at 2, go to the end, so we omit that in steps of 2. And finally, the other way around, it's A, colon, colon, minus 1. Okay? This is really very much what we did for lists at the beginning of the first session. Now, things are a bit more interesting in higher dimensions. So we are going to play a game. I'm showing you, showing you a matrix. I'm not showing you the solution here, I'm showing you the solution. So, you take this matrix, I show you the matrix, I show you which matrix elements you should select. They are just highlighted. And it's your turn to develop the proper slicing. So, the main information which you need at this point is that for each direction, for each axis, for each dimension of the matrix, you need a slice. So in the simplest case of just one matrix element, well, we have to specify the axis 0. Axis 0 is this one here. I'll talk a little bit more about that as we go on. So this is column 0, 1, 2. So that would be 2. And then 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So I could write 2,5, or if I see more easily that this is the number 3 column from the end, I could write minus 3. So let's try to do this. This is the 5A. So let's create an array. A is mp.a range of 40.3 shape. 5,8. Let's take a look at it. So that's precisely the array which I have shown in my presentation. This is the array which you are going to use now to exercise the slicing. And if I say 8, 2, minus 3, then I get indeed 21. Okay. And now the game starts. So, whoops. Okay, I have one more example where I give the solution, but then the game really starts. I mean, you'll have to do some work, no question about that. Okay, so that's what I mentioned briefly. First case, it was just one matrix element. So here, we really have two slices. So what does it mean? We start at the beginning, because no number two here. Start here. Up to, but not including the row number 3. We start here at the beginning, up to, but not including the column number 5. That gives us this array. So let's try it out. Indeed. let's see then, I give you another solution. Now it's your turn. So, what about this culture? Now, there's not a unique solution. There are various solutions possible here.
L minus 3, L minus 8.
Column minus 3 would start at the beginning. But you're close.
Try it out before you say it.
Yeah. But it is a hint for others, they could try to correct this. And but I mean, the idea is a good idea. I mean, obviously it's easier to count from the back than from the beginning. So using the minus 3 is a good idea.
You start with minus 3, minus 0.
Yeah, it's minus 3 colon, minus 3 colon, exactly. Okay, so this was easy. Let's make it a bit more complicated. It's also easy. We'll get more complicated as we go on. First index is the number of the rows. We need all rows. That means, what do we write as a bias for the rows? Column. And there's just one column, the column number 3. So column, comma 3, should in principle work. That's what. Now you could say, okay, I'm writing something here, but in fact, this figure here was created by putting in the slice, so we can be sure that this slice is really corresponding to this image. And you can try it out without the plots. Okay, let's try another one. Success simply becomes doing more complicated things. This is still not too complicated. Same thing, you could have used minus as well, or minus 3 or so, but yeah, 1, 3, 2, 6. It'll be more interesting in a couple of slides. Column 2, column 2, 0, column 3. Yeah. And then zero is strictly speaking not needed because the default is starting at the beginning. So this would be good enough.
One question about 1D arrays. Can a 1D array be a column vector also?
Yes, yes. You can have a, I mean, instead of a, let's say a shape 5, you can have a shape 1,5. Which would mean that there is a zero direction and a one direction. And 1,5, you can have 5,1. We are coming to that as we go on. Now this one here is so complicated that I give you the solution right away because we are using something which we haven't discussed yet, but maybe I can try this out first just to confirm that we get indeed these matrix elements. And then my question would be, how can we explain this? Yeah, but what is the logic? I mean, okay, it's every third element, but why? I mean, this is no longer the slicing syntax. This is what's known as fancy indexing, because it's much more fancy than the slices. So somebody can confirm that this works. Okay, then it's worth discussing the solution. What's going on here? Which elements are selected?
Yeah, so you are creating a logical mask, which then has ones when this condition is met, right?
Yes.
And, zero and four, or two and four.
Then they are
and
true.
Then if you just apply this mask to A, then all these elements where the condition is true are first.
Right. So, just to take this apart, what you just said, if I say 8% 3, oops, equals zero. This is in principle an array. So I'm doing an operation now on each element of the array. So I get, as you just explained, a matrix, a Boolean matrix, with elements true and false. And these elements are true if the element in A is divisible by 3 without any rest. And what is selected, I put an A bracket around it, is precisely the matrix elements which are where the this Boolean matrix has elements true. No. It doesn't have the doesn't have a two-dimensional form anymore, but that's in general not possible because if you do this fancy indexing, it's not all assured, and actually you see it here that in each line you have the same number of elements. So that cannot work. This is no longer a square matrix. Ready for an even more complicated example? Well, the solution actually is very simple because here you have the coordinates of each element. Row 1, the elements 3 and 4. Row 2, the elements 2 and 5. And row 3, the elements 3 and 4. Again, this won't be a two-dimensional matrix. If you do that, then you get A of 1. Just get these matrix elements 12, 18, 21, 27, and 20. So you see, indexing can be extremely flexible. Do whatever you like. Are there any questions? I mean, what's really important here is slicing. I mean, fancy indexing I will use not as often as the regular slicing, so that's something you can also look up at any time if you really need it. Let's maybe look at the applications. Yeah?
How could I cast, for example, this Boolean mask into integer? Is it just np.int, point int, and then, because this only worked for single numbers but not for matrices, when I say it. Because when I had integers, then I could only multiply this mask to A, and then I would only have zeros where this condition is not met, for example. And one.
Oh, you. So you want to put zeros in the places where it's
skip. Yeah, for example, when I have true and false, and I just would convert it to integer, then I would have ones and zeros, and then when I multiply this mask to A, then I would have the same form or the same shape, but only the. At the positions where a 1 was multiplied, the numbers still there.
So let me see. I mean, what you would like to have, so let's... here we have our matrix A, okay? And now you want to... You want to change all elements which are not divisible by C or which are divisible by C?
We can take this mask that we have, then you would need to cast this into an integer.
Why should I do this? If I understood you well, you wanted to manipulate the elements.
That was just a more basic question. How can I typecast the Boolean matrix, for example, in something else?
His question was, why would you want to do that? And the answer to that is probably not for the reason you're after, because there's a different solution to that. That's what he was going to show.
Okay. No, I wanted just to know how to cast matrices in Python, or some data.
Let me see. This doesn't make sense, actually.
Isn't there a cast method?
I don't know, I just tried this one, it didn't work, so not for magic.
Right, this is an os. There's an S. This is something, frankly, I do so rarely that I need to look it up, but there is an. More common is that you use this mask to assign a certain value to the selected elements. That's more common, but the conversion is possible. There's an this is something one can look at. But I think what's more important is that you can use such Boolean masks to select matrix elements for which you assign them. Okay, let's try to do the example. The problem is to produce a list of prime numbers by using the sieve of Eratosthenes. And I'll show you how this works. If you don't recall that. Basically, the idea is the following. You have a list of numbers, let's say from 0 to 49, and you want to have all prime numbers on this list of numbers. Now, 0 and 1 are no prime numbers, so they are exceptional, great origin. And then you just go through this list and you start at the first element, which is 2, and you cross out every second element because every second element is divisible by 2. Then you take the next element, which is 3, and you cross out every third element. Actually, you only start at 3 squared, at 9, because the 6 was already crossed out because it's divisible by 2. So you can always start at the square of this number. Next number is 5, you cross out 25 and 35, and so on up to 7. Since there cannot be another divisor, a relevant divisor, larger than 7, because let's say 49 would be divisible by 11, if that were the case, which is not the case of course, then there would be another divisor which is smaller. So we had already treated this case. We are finished here. Everything which is left over are prime numbers. How do we solve such a situation by means of numpy arrays? And that's basically the example. So we have a maximum of 50. We have an array running from 0 to 49. That's why the max is 50. So these are our integers. That's what I just showed you in this, this picture. That's just our list, our 1D array. Then, in addition, we have a list which defines whether a given number is a prime number. A priori, we assume that all numbers are prime numbers, right? Because afterwards we are crossing out numbers. So, basically, the idea is all these are possibly prime numbers, but once we cross them out, we put the entry to false. So we know this number is not a prime number, 40 is not a prime number, and all elements in the end which are still set to true are prime numbers. So, say you want to have an array of two boolean, true, false, and since we want to have ones, true, now we have to take ones. I showed you before, if I do this with np zeros, D-type boolean, then I get all false. If I have ones, I get all true. So in principle, all the elements from 0 to 49 are prime numbers. But we already know that the first two elements are no prime numbers. So that's a slice going from the beginning to 2, include, excludes the 2. And then we go through the rest. We start at 2, for all the indices, j from 2 up to the square root of the largest number. If the number is a prime, then you have to cross out all multiples starting at the square. So that's the situation where we can use our slicing. We start at this number square in steps of this number. This is now precisely an application of the slicing syntax which we just have used, where you might have asked yourself, why do we select these strange elements of a matrix? This is precisely such a situation. We select all elements for which we can now say, if j is a prime, that these numbers are no primes. Starting at j squared, in steps of j, all these numbers which we can find there are no primes. Here I print out the array is prime. Well, actually integers is prime. So this is now this fancy indexing, I have a Boolean array, and only those elements of integers where its prime is true, the still potential candidates for a prime number, are printed. So when I run this, you can see successively how the number of potential primes is reduced to the very end when only really prime numbers are left, and that's what I print out here. So let's see. So at the beginning we have basically everything starting at 2. Right? Then we identify 2 as the leading prime number here. We start out at 4, taking every second element away, and we are left with this array. It still, of course, has quite a few numbers which are not prime numbers, for example, 21. Then the next number is 3. We start out at 9, in steps of 3 crossing out all remaining elements, and so on, until we reach 7. The 49 is crossed out in the last step, and what's left are just prime numbers. And this is, even though it doesn't look that compact, but I mean, I would in general, of course, not have this line here, because that's just, let's say, for debugging purposes. And here we just define 0 and 1 not as prime numbers. The main part is this one here, which is actually very simple. If I have identified a prime number, cross out the prime numbers, the number starting at j squared instead of j. So that would be the application of Boolean arrays, of slicing, and of fancy indexing. So this way, the things which we have just discussed can be applied in a practical example. Now, another important aspect, which to some extent we have already discussed, but which from my experience occasionally causes problems in understanding our axes. In particular, if you go to a higher dimensional matrix element, I mean, one dimensional is trivial, you just have one index in this one dimension. Two dimensions is also still okay, but in three dimensions you have to know where you are, which plane you're talking about. So it makes sense to talk a little bit about axes. So if you are working with matrices, then you basically know how the index notation for matrices works. Basically, it works like this. You have the element A11 here. The next element is A12, A13. So the second index denotes the column. Right? The first index denotes the row. So here in row 3, we have all the elements A31, A32, A33. So first element is the row, second element is the column. And it works precisely the same way in NumPy. So for a NumPy array, well, the first element is the row. So this is our axis 0, 0, 1, and this is our axis 1. The only difference is that in Python we start with index 0. So in the matrix you don't do that, you start with index 1. Here we start with index 0. But the association of indices here with rows and columns works in just the same way. The first index is axis 0, this goes from top to bottom, axis 1 goes from left to right. So you can try this out by taking an array and calculate its sum. There are actually different ways to calculate the sum of an array. You can calculate the sum of all matrix elements, or you can calculate the sum across a certain axis. Let's take a look at that. So, you create an array. Maybe not a quadratic array, so then it's, what doesn't matter, it could also be a quadratic array. Let me create an array of elements. You J in comma 4. Look at that. And the array looks like that. And now you can do the sum over everything. All the sum along x is 0, which should be from top to down, should give you 4 values. All the sum along x is 1. So let's start by doing the sum along x is 0. So mp dot sum of a x is equal 0. And you see you get 4 matrix elements, 4 and 8 is 12, 1 plus 5 plus 9 is 15, and so on. So clearly this is x is 0. Whereas x is 1 is horizontal. So mp dot sum of a x is 1. So 6, 1 plus 2 plus 3 is 6, 4 plus 5 plus 7, 6 plus 7 is 22. And 8 plus 9 plus 10 plus 11 is 38. If you want to have the sum of everything, just say mp sum of a, the sum of all matrix elements, 6 plus 22 plus 38 is 66. Okay. So you have two axes and they are well defined. Axis 0 is the first index, axis 1 the second index. And if you're at higher dimensions, and so on. So...
What was this one column?
Sorry?
Your sum of all columns. So if you want to sum just one column, you said second column.
Oh, if you want to extract one of the values, or...?
Yeah, no, we can just bracket, for example, 0.
Oh, sure, you can take a subarray if you want. You can slice it and calculate the sum only for that array. This you can do. I mean, for example, you could, you could say A of 0, and you get 6. Now, let's go to higher dimensions. That's a little bit more complicated. But actually, it's not that complicated. So this is an array with 24 matrix elements, which is a 2 by 3 by 4 matrix. So it's a three-dimensional matrix. I try to represent it here. So you have here two planes, if you like. So you see these red brackets? They are the outer level. And everything as next element, these green parts here, is basically what's denoted by x is 0. So the index of x is 0 is 0 for the plane here in front and 1 for the plane in the back. And then x is 1 contains, that's the rows, contains here the entries 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and so on. So you have this level structure, this onion type structure. And if you realize how that looks like, and I'm leaving up this image when you do the exercise, we briefly go to the exercise, but then I'll be back to this image here. What you should do is try to make planes here, like the front plane, all the plane consisting of 0, 1, 2, 3, 12, 13, 14, 15. Or this plane here, for example, 3, 7, 11, 15, 19, 20, 20. Try to cut in various ways through this three-dimensional array. So, what we do is we produce this array here. That's precisely what I've shown you in the picture. And P A range of 24, V shape 2, 3, 4. That's the three-dimensional array, which you can already use here. And now, just try to do cuts through x is 0, x is 1, x is 2, and compare what you get with this image here. Just play a little bit around and try to do cuts in different directions. it's not so important which cut you use exactly, but try to dress in neutral planes. Zero, we want to have element zero and everything else in the other directions. What does that mean? Well, in axis zero, we take the plane zero, which consists of the front plane 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Right? It's just this plane. This is axis zero here. This would be index zero. This would be index one. So we get this point. Now I'm doing the same thing for axis 1. So if I take index 0 for axis 1, I should have 0, 1, 2, 3, 12, 13, 14, 15. This kind. So let's do that. Colon, 0, colon. Indeed, 0, 1, 2, 3, 12, 13, 14, 15. And finally, if I do the same thing for x is 2, this would be everything where x is 2 has the index of 0. This would be 0, 4, 8, 12, 16, 20. A, colon, colon, 0, 0, 4, 8, 12, 16, 20. And of course, I could use other indices depending on the size of the matrix. But you see that in this way, I can get cuts to the multi-dimensional array. And of course, if you now have a 10-dimensional array, which idea of how the array looks like. But in principle, by having an understanding of the three-dimensional array, you know more or less which index is responsible for what part. Array. Is this here or are there questions? Or is it already complicated? No? Starting to get complicated. Also coming to the last part of the tutorial, so the end is always a bit more difficult. And the important part here actually is that you have, I think for today, that you have seen certain things. I think if you go out of this room and say, okay, NuMPa is something I really have to look at that's useful, then that's what I want to achieve. Of course, you have to go back to the documentation and look up things. There are lots of things which I cannot talk about today, but at least you should have an idea of what NuMPa can be useful for. What is A of zero? Out. of 0, well, just takes 0 as the index for the first axis, because you don't give additional indices, so that's the front plane of our array. And a bit more interesting is actually this one here, A dot 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 comma 0. What is dot 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 in everyday use? Well, it stands for everything else somehow. That's precisely what it is. Dot 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 is for everything else. So the first index, the second index, on the last index is 0. So that's precisely the same thing as this one here. Activist. That's quite nice, except that you're not allowed to use dot 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 several times. So of course you can't do something like that. Because there's no way how Python could figure out what you really need. But sometimes if you have an array, for some reason you don't know its dimension, you don't care. Don't care about the leading indices, you can do something like that. That's fine. So occasional. But that's mostly for higher dimensional matrices. Now, we were already talking about doing operations on matrices in the sense of multiplying them by a number, or maybe adding a number. And that's something which we need to explore in more detail. So I create two matrices. The first matrix, these are just one-dimensional matrices. First one is running from 0 to 3. The second from 4 to 7. So, supposedly you can add arrays. That's not very surprising, so you add arrays element by element, like you would add vectors, for example. The question is, what happens when you multiply the arrays? Now, depending on your background, you might have different expectations. Some of you might think in terms of a scalar product. Multiplying vectors gives you some scalar product. That's not what's happening. Multiplication is always element-wise. Good thing, this is special for 1D. No, it's not. Define 2D arrays and multiply them. Please try it out just to see how it works. Just define two very simple 2D arrays. Actually, you can just reshape A and B if you like. And do a reshape 2,2, for example, on these arrays here. Then you have two 2D arrays. And just multiply it. So let's try this. I just reshape these two arrays. I get two by two arrays. They're not nicely presented here, but you can see there's an array 0, 1, 2, 3, and another array 4, 5, 6, 7. And I'm not going to multiply them. And you see, 0 times 4 is 0, 1 times 5 is 5, 2 times 6 is 12, 3 times 7 is 21. So this is definitely an element-wise multiplication. It's not a matrix multiplication. Now you might say, this is really disappointing. I want you to do linear algebra, multiply matrices, matrices with vectors, and so on. Calculate scalar products. Maybe calculate determinants. Would be great. 3x3 is already some work to do. Calculating 4x4 matrices is really hard work. This should be done by the computer. So, I mean, where's all the linear algebra? Oh, it's there, of course. But let me just ask, who is unfamiliar with matrix multiplications? It's no problem. I'm going to explain it. Don't be shy. Everybody knows matrix multiplication. Great, okay. Then I assume that you really know it. So there are actually four ways to do matrix multiplication. You can do these blocks here, they stand for a matrix. So either you use NP dot matrix A times matrix B. You can also use A dot dot of B, which means multiply A by B. Or very recently, it can be debated, but that's a big advance, but there is a sort of multiplication operator now. A at B. That's a matrix multiplication. So let's try that. But this really depends on having a relatively recent installation. So we need 3.5 at least, and now pi at least 1.10, which nowadays is no problem. But so let's see, NP dot of A comma B should always work. Let's check. Here the product is 6, 7, 26, 31. Indeed, 6, 7, 26, 31. You could also say A dot of B. It's the same thing. And you could as well do A and B. I think if the last command doesn't work, then for some reason we either have an outdated Python or outdated MemCache. So of course you can do a matrix multiplication, you can multiply vectors, you can multiply vectors with the matrices. Okay. So let's do another example, some practical example, random walks. So this is basically simulating that you're going out tonight in Erlangen having 3 beers, 4 beers, I don't know how many beers, and at some point you're doing a, what we call a random walk. It means you do a step, but in an arbitrary direction. Want to simulate how fast you get to your hotel. If you know random walks, you know that if you go at a constant speed, you advance only with the square root of time, which is already much slower than proportional to time, and your direction might be pretty arbitrary, so hitting the hotel is even more unlikely. So maybe 2 years are enough, but you have to know. So let's try to simulate a random walk.
But it's still more likely than if you always walk in one direction.
Okay, so let's assume you do 10,000 steps, and let's see, you try this experiment 5 times. So suppose you're here for the tutorial, for the conference next 2 days, and maybe even for the sprints, contributing to open software. Then you have 5 chances to walk home with pretty much beer. So let's have 5 realizations. So the idea is that we choose a random angle. This will give us a matrix of size length or shape length of walk and realizations, a 10,000 by 5 matrix filled with random numbers. We multiply them by 2 pi, because the angle goes from 0 to 2 pi, you can walk in any direction. And then we produce an array in a quite interesting way. So we already have seen that in principle we can take an array and apply a function to the full array. So, we take the cosine of all these angles, and now we do a commutative sum. So, we have an array. Suppose you have an array 1, 2, 3, 4. Maybe I'll show you here. Let me see how this works. Then let's say, so the cumulative sum goes in the following way. This is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and so on. So 0 plus 1 is 1, 1 plus 2 is 3, 3 plus, maybe this is actually not a good example, because you're always adding the previous ones. Maybe a better example. So 0 plus 2 is 2, 2 plus 4 is 6, 6 plus, in this case, 6 is 12, 12, 12 plus 8 is 20, and so on. So it's always the partial sum from the beginning up to a given point. You add up these steps. That's what we are doing here. And we do this in x direction and in y direction. So we take cosine and sum. And then we plot the whole thing. Hopefully your hotel is somewhere here, and you might hear it. Okay? It's in bad shape. So these would be random walks. By the way, nowadays there are people who don't like this code for a pretty strange reason. And this is just, if you have Python 3.6, say for a month, or tau. Does somebody know the value of tau? No. It's one of the changes in Python 3.6, maybe not the most important one. Nobody knows what tau is? Still doesn't exist in NumPy. So we could write how here?
And now I understand what you're doing.
Exactly, that's the point. That's why 28th of June is now celebrated as the Tau Day, because now people all of a sudden understand. Okay. Actually, 2pi is much more often in formula than pi, so it makes a lot of sense, maybe. It's available in the math module and in the complex math module even, where it makes maybe even more sense. So, cosine and sine are tautologically, not 2pi very little. Okay, anyway, you see that since I didn't define a c, I had restarted the kernel responding to a question before, so I don't have a fixed c now, and this figure will look different every time. Now I can also look at the distance from the origin. The hypotenuses. So this is the distance you're making as a function of time. And you could also look at the mean of the square. This should roughly go linearly. But this is distance squared, so if you take the square root, you advance only the square root of time. Okay, so you see here, I mean, with NumPy arrays, here in such situations, you don't talk much about the slices. Right? You just use arrays as objects, you operate with functions on these objects, and probably Gael Barocco will tell you in his SciPy tutorial a bit about special functions in SciPy. There are lots of special functions in SciPy which also allow you to operate on arrays. And this makes, makes code very readable, and actually in such a notebook, when you're analyzing data which you have stored in arrays, this usually makes for a pretty clear code. But there's also an issue about speed. Let me show that. Here we're going to time a few operations. So the idea here is that we define range of numbers, 1 million numbers here, integers from 0 to 1 million minus 1, and we want to calculate the square. How much time does it take? Now this is run several times to get to determine an average. Takes about 1.3 milliseconds or 9 milliseconds. Might differ on your computer depending on the processor and so on. Now if you would do that with the list comprehension, suppose you would generate a list where you go through this range here and square each element in this range and put it in the list. How long would that take? Takes about 300 milliseconds. Now imagine, it happens that occasionally you have a program that will run, let's say for a day, maybe for the weekend. Now the difference between 1.3 milliseconds and 300 milliseconds is almost a factor of 300. It really matters whether your program runs a day or 300 days, right? Well, if that would be the part which does all the work. But I mean, here you can gain a lot if this is really the part where you're losing your time. Let's do this for a sign. I mean, you could just use this array and evaluate the sign of all these values in here, or we could try list comprehension and do it individually on every element of this range. So this is 3.3 milliseconds. This is 17 milliseconds, still like a factor of 5. So you see that here NumPy can already give you quite some advantage in speed. That depends a bit on how many elements you have in your array. But speed-wise, you might have a significant advantage. Now one point which I should in any case address now, that's kind of important, this broadcast. Maybe I briefly go through these. That's very brief. This is a list of operations which you can use on arrays. So see, you have all kinds of mathematical functions, some operations, work with complex numbers. There are a lot of different things. This slide is mainly to suggest that you should go to the documentation at some point. And if you need something, you'll find it there. More important because...
There's an intersection between NumPy and SciPy.
Oh, yeah.
These functions.
Yeah.
Is there any good choice of them?
Usually... I think, but I'm not sure whether we can say this in general. Just try it out for some time. I mean, these are different implementations, in fact. Just try it out. For the function shown. I mean, I couldn't say it now for all functions, but there are differences. So, what's really important to understand is broadcasting. I mean, you have noticed that we were able to multiply a matrix by a factor. You can also add a number to a matrix, which in a sense is strange because we have said this works element-wise. And one number is actually it's a mini array, it's one number. How does it work? Well, there is a clear rule or set of rules for so-called broadcasting. You can do this joint operation, you can do this broadcast, in the sense I'll explain this in more detail, then the arrays have exactly the same shape. Adding two arrays, if they are of same size, no problem. The arrays all have the same number of dimensions, and the length of each dimension is either a common length or one. I'll explain this in more detail. This is just a list of requirements. All the arrays that have too few dimensions can have their shapes dependent with the dimension of length 1 to satisfy property 2. So basically, you can blow up your small array to the size of the full array. Now, this sounds pretty complicated. I hope that the following images make this a bit clearer. So I have an array of shape 3 rows, 4 columns. So what actually happens that we multiply NP ones, an array of ones by 10 before, was actually the following. I have 1 10, and this can be extended to the full shape of this array. That's what's called broadcasting. Right? This cell broadcasts this to the other cells. And now I can add these two, or I can multiply them. This also works if the first dimension here, this one here, corresponds here. Then I can just broadcast in this direction. This doesn't work if I have a 3 here. Now, what should I do here? It doesn't fit these requirements. And here I can just broadcast in the other directions. Here I cannot do it. It also works if I have shape 3, 1. Then you see the 3 degrees and the 1 instead of the 4 is possible, because then I can broadcast in this direction. So if you go back, either it has exactly the same shape, or, now let's read this again, the arrays all have the same number of dimensions, and the length of each dimension is either a common length or 1. That's precisely what we have here. The dimensions are the same, and they are the shape entries are either the same, 3, 3, or one of them is 1. Then you can broadcast in this way. That's requirement number 2. Or the arrays that have too few dimensions can have their shape repended with the dimension of length 1, satisfy property 2. That is this one here. 4 can be prepended by 1, then I have an array of shape 1, 4. And then I can fulfill the requirement. 4 is equal, and the 1 and the 3 work fine, because I can broadcast here. The 3 doesn't work because 1s have to be prepended. So even if I prepend the 1, 1, 3 doesn't fit at all this shape. So that's how broadcasting works. And for a beginner, this is a place where one likely makes mistakes. So it's a good idea maybe to look again at these images if you encounter any problems. Now at this point, I'm running out of time. That's fine, because at the end I just had a few applications, and let me just briefly look, click through them so that you have an idea of the interest, the material we have to you. That's the microcode set. Actually, in the GitHub repository for the exercises, you also find a notebook with solutions. So if you're interested in understanding how such a situation can be solved, just go to this notebook and look at the solutions. They're not too complicated and might give you some idea. I don't solve this problem, I'm just solving this problem from Mandelbrot. Calculation of pi by simulation, some linear algebra, eigenvalue problems. Just here for people interested in eigenvalue problems, and of course you can calculate eigenvalues, eigenvectors, inner products, outer products of vectors, and so on. There are some statistics routines. And also that might be interesting for some of you, image processing. Just by having 2π arrays, you can, for example, look up whether values in this image are above 128 or below, and set the defaults to 0 or 1. You can put a frame around it. Remember, mask arrays has indexing. You can change the contrast, or you can put a mask here. All these things can be easily done with NumPy arrays, because, as I mentioned at the very beginning, images are in principle also data arrays. And you can treat them in one. You'll find the solutions in the notebook. That is, I'll just show you. You can find if you're interested in that. So here you, when you have downloaded this tutorial exercises, there's also the notebook with the solutions. There's also the full presentation as a PDF. If you want to take another look at it, you're welcome to download all this. If you want to get the whole repository and you don't know how to work with GitHub, tomorrow will be a tutorial on GitHub. This is not a commercial break. I'm giving a tutorial tomorrow on Git, on using version control, which is actually something which you haven't used version control so far, and you're doing program developing, which I think is worth taking a look at, independently of whether you compromise as well or not. Version control is something that can be extremely helpful in practical work. So if you're around, you're very welcome. And if there are any questions, I'll be around for the full week, so please feel free to talk to me, ask me any questions. Thank you very much for the attention. I hope you have a successful work with you.